Hello and welcome to North Country Matters. My name is Donna Seymour and I'm a member of the St. Lawrence County League of Women's Voters, one of the civic partners for this show. Today we're going to be talking about the St. Lawrence County Opioid Task Force. And our guest is Dana McGuire, who is the St. Lawrence County Public Health Director. Dana, welcome back to North Country Matters. Nice to have you back with us. At the end of last year, St. Lawrence County launched an opioid task force to begin the process to understand and combat the opioid addiction crisis facing many North Country communities and families. And this is a crisis that is all across the country. It certainly isn't something that is unique to the North Country. And we actually had a $75,000 state grant to kickstart the effort. Last fall, here on North Country Matters, I did a series of candidate conversations with some of the people running for St. Lawrence County Legislature. And one of the things that struck me about those conversations was that every candidate, regardless of party or of anything else, they identified opioids as a top concern. And that is the kind of political consensus that's hard to achieve on a good day. So the fact that everybody came to the table thinking that that was a problem really made it easier the next month for the county task force to get started, didn't it?
Yes, it did.
So we've seen a lot of information about the opioid death toll across the country. In fact, opioids now are the cause of more deaths than car accidents, according to the National Safety Council. Your probability of dying from opioids is 1 in 96. The probability of dying in a motor vehicle crash is 1 in 103. So let's start talking, Dana, about the problem in terms of what does the crisis look like here in St. Lawrence County? What do we know?
Well, so there were 24 counties that received the funding. And one of the factors they looked at is what is the opioid, kind of the burden of that county. And so one of the a few of the areas that have been high for us, when you look at the Tri-County area, which includes Lewis and Jefferson counties, and as compared to the state, is the discharges due to an opioid use, and then the emergency department kind of admissions due to them as well. The other thing that we have going for us is that we have a lot of infants born that are kind of already in the withdrawal, and so that just kind of heightens things as well. As far as, so our department looks at deaths from the coroner's program. In 2018, we only have on record that there was 5 from the overdose. From 2017, there was 16. So one of the things with the grant, though, that we want to do is make sure the data that we're capturing is really capturing what we want it to, because it matters what's put on the death certificate, what the primary, what the secondary death kind of aspect was, and so how we look at that and how we document that can be very important. And so that's kind of the stats we have. And so the other thing is our department only knows from the death point of view. To really look at how many of the overdoses we have, we can look at like ERs, we can look at like the 911 calls, but based on what somebody says when they call may or may not, you know, may not be what gets kind of logged into. So the accuracy of what's going on is really hard to kind of to determine right now. One of the things that with the grant we'd like to get in place is this application called the OD map. And what that is, it's a mapping feature that the person who arrives on scene, so it can be the EMS, it could be the police, they can actually just document where they are and what happened. You know, did they give Narcan? Could they reverse it? Or was there like a death? And so we are working to get that started here for our county. One of the things that is a challenge is most times this application is used on like a town or like a city basis. We are doing it countywide. And so while we're a large county and there's not that many people, we have a lot of different kind of the systems in place. And so trying to get a standardized way for all of the first responders to able to get that kind of information into the system is what we're working on. So they have piloted it, it's out there, we're waiting for our first case to be logged into the system.
And one of the things that, you know, you mentioned that really struck me is the fact that that's only the people who end up in the medical system. There are lots more people who are addicted to opioids who may never get to the point where they're in a medical crisis, isn't there?
Yes.
So that's kind of the under the water part of the iceberg, isn't it?
Yes.
Yeah. And you mentioned Narcan as one of the ways that first responders would do it. There's been a lot of training about that and a lot more availability in the last couple years compared to what it was earlier too in terms of that, isn't it? So that first responders are better trained and they are more aware of what the symptoms are.
Yes, and what I'm trying to do, so I've had our entire department trained and I'm working to get the whole county trained. Mm-hmm. And now I'm just contacting all the libraries because usually when we hold trainings on something, it's always in the large townships. But a library is something that most townships have.
Right.
Libraries are also where an overdose can happen.
Mm-hmm.
And so I am just in the process of making all the phone calls, and all of the ones that I have spoken to say, yes, you know, thanks for kind of thinking of us. So I'm hoping to put a series on this summer that will just go around to the libraries and then the librarians, the people in towns can feel like they can go for the training.
Yeah, and that's one thing we have up here is a very strong public library system through the North Country system. So that is a great resource and a good way for you to leverage an existing community entity that is very much trusted in that community, isn't
exactly.
it? So that's great. So what are some of the reasons why St. Lawrence County is hit so hard by the opioid crisis? Kind of what makes us a target for opioids in terms of just where we live?
Well, I think one of the reasons is possibly due to the prescription kind of methods of, you know, maybe not really looking at how much, you know, pain kind of relief somebody needs after a surgery. So those guidelines have been put into place and making sure that education gets out to the providers. I think that's a good place to start. I think with the mental health issues, you know, some of the like economic kind of lower incomes and the poverty here in the county, I think that plays a role into it as well.
We did a North Country Matters show 2-3 years ago with Timmy Currier, who's the mayor of Messina and the former police chief there, and he was talking about the economic despair of that community and how as the economics changed and some of the big and better employers were downsizing and disappearing, the drugs was moving in. And he said you have to fight it on more than one level, and a lot of it is economics because it's an easy way to make money, or at least it appears to be that for folks. So Dana, let's talk about what are the opioids, what kind of drugs are they, how are they prescribed and used in terms of, you know, what would somebody, in fact, one of the things that Tim Currier mentioned was that people would go through medicine cabinets, their grandparents' medicine cabinets, and I think we're all guilty of leaving things in the back corner after we don't need it anymore instead of getting rid of it. And the drug take-back days have helped because now people are more aware of the fact that they probably have things sitting at home that shouldn't be there.
Well, so opioids are a class of drugs for pain relief. So there are really three types. There's the prescription type, and that's like the Oxycontins, Vicodin, so if you have a surgery and you get a prescription. Then there's the fentanyl, which is much more kind of powerful. And that's usually prescribed, say, in like an advanced person with, say, cancer, because you need a little bit more of a pain relief. Then the third class is really like the heroin or the street drug.
Mm-hmm.
And so when you look at what has happened in this epidemic, like all of those have kind of played a role. I think it really, if you look at the waves of things happening, the prescription drugs kind of started to increase. The heroin played a role, but the fentanyl is what has kind of really increased, and it's really been a contributor to all of the deaths because it is kind of so powerful.
Right.
And some of the drugs or some of the lesser ones or some of the other drugs that, that people use can be laced with it. And mm-hmm. if you're not kind of, like aware of that, because it's like so much greater, that's what can set you up.
Okay, so this crisis touches every family. I could tell you stories about people that I know that are in my immediate circle that have been, I think everybody could tell those stories. So the St. Lawrence County Task Force got started back in December. You've had several meetings. Who are the stakeholder groups that are identified and on the task force so that we get a sense of who's you brought to the table to address some of the issues?
Yeah. So this Friday, we're coming to the fifth meeting, mm-hmm. and we have had great turnouts since the start. So we're about up at about like 50 to 60 people. And we have people from health practitioners, law enforcement, and the sheriff's office. We have the citizen who wants to know more. Mm-hmm. We have all of the community-based kind of organizations, their partners in all the other work we do. Mm-hmm. We have some of the pharmacists, we have the legislators, we have the DA's office, we have the county jail. I mean, you name it. We have someone from the faith, kind of the community, mm-hmm. and we really have good representation. What I have hopes for, though, is we get more people who have been impacted or who are on the path, because I think it's really important to make sure that what we deem as being a priority is really what a priority, mm-hmm. you know, what some of the challenges, what some mm-hmm. of the successes have been when you have been kind of in the trenches, I think is important. So that's what I'm kind of hopeful
for. So you want to put the human face on this crisis as well, so that people really understand that who's getting involved in this kind of thing, who's been perhaps in pain, gotten addicted, and it's not a crime and punishment thing. This is really a whole person health task force, isn't it, in many ways?
Yes, but I think you can pull people together who think they might be doing the right thing.
Right.
And unless you have the people there who've been through it and, you know, who can give some feedback,
right,
or who can help to make the ideas of what we should do, I mean, I think that that's really what we need to have as mm-hmm. well.
So give us your goals. What are the goals of the task force? Because you have to set out what your parameters are and what you hope to accomplish if you're going to actually be successful.
I do that, yeah.
Yeah.
Well, so one of the main things is to try to change the stigma mm-hmm. just around what people think about substance use. Because unless you change what people think about it, it's going to be hard to bring forward any of the priorities we have. So that's one of the main things. We want to provide education, and that's really to all sectors, to schools, to families, to health practitioners, to the providers, you know, kind of all around. We want to be able to link people, so the people who come to the task force, bring them together to talk about the mm-hmm. issues that they're having. Let them know, you know, like when there is an event, what's going on, who does what. But then also link people who need services to the services that mm-hmm. they need. And we want to get kind of more data, like I talked about.
Right.
And not
right.
just more, but making sure we have the data that we need to make the decisions mm-hmm. and to do the planning.
Right. And I would think a big part of this is going to be changing public opinion, because we have quite literally been fighting the war on drugs for my entire lifetime, and drugs is still winning, unfortunately, because it isn't something that you can look at as strictly as a crime and punishment or law enforcement thing. Anybody who works on public policy issues, there's no one single approach to understanding an issue or finding a solution. And one of the ways I think that public health has so much to offer when you look at these kinds of issues is when you look at a problem through the lens of public health, it really changes the conversation, doesn't it? And by bringing all of those stakeholders that you've identified to the table, they're also hearing about each one of the problem from a different point of view and a different perspective. And that's got to broaden the approaches, doesn't it?
It does.
So one of the things that you've taken, one of the approaches you've taken with the task force is really to explore in depth some of these issues around opioid use and abuse. that expand our understanding. Talk a little bit about what some of the meetings have focused on and what you've come away from those meetings with that broader understanding.
So we're kind of still in the forming stages mm-hmm. of the task force and really looking at what should the structure be. And really, when you get a task force together, it's because we all have a common goal and we should do something. So the way I see the task force meetings is it's always going to be a place to do networking and make sure mm-hmm. that we know what's going on. Two, we try to have a topic that is kind of a hot topic so that we gain something from it. So like you've mentioned, we had the jail come mm-hmm. 1 month to talk about the services that they provide, because 90% of the inmates do have a substance use disorder. Mm-hmm. Last month we did a topic on the poverty here in this county. Friday we're talking about the stigma. For upcoming meetings, we did finally come up with a name for our task force. So we are St. Lawrence County Partners for Substance Use Prevention.
Okay.
So we're kind of staying away from the opioid use because there is so much kind of mm-hmm. substance use. Mm-hmm. And so for June and for the July meetings, we are going to talk about vaping. There's a lot of mm-hmm. questions about that and what's being put into those instruments. Mm-hmm. And then the following month, we'll talk about marijuana, because that's mm-hmm. kind of leads itself from the vaping topic. And so those are the topics that we talk about. And then we really now need to start to get some of the subcommittees started to actually look at what are we going on to do. So the four focus areas for the group are to do the prevention, mm-hmm. To think about interventions and treatments, and then the recovery process. So this will be the first meeting that we have a little bit of work group time to kind of organize ourselves for what your interest is in, and try to see what are the things that we should start to work on. So this is just kind of the first stages of starting to do kind of work plans, if that's what you want to call them. So I see it as kind of a time to do a connection, to gain some information, and then to work with partners to try to get some things done.
I think that piece of information that you just gave us about that 90% of people who are in the county jail are they're addicted to some kind of substance abuse, whether it's alcohol or drugs or something else. You don't think about going to jail as part of your health care, but health care obviously is a huge part of a successful remediation out of the criminal justice program, isn't it? And that takes a set of resources that we probably haven't thought about really putting into the criminal justice system, doesn't it?
Right, and I would say that our county jail has been pretty proactive mm-hmm. on really looking what are the services they need. I mean, from that meeting, I learned that they have some of the college courses that the inmates can take. And we know that if you have higher education mm-hmm. and then that you can continue that you're more likely to stay on the path.
And you also mentioned mental health services, and I suspect that if we looked at the percentage of inmates with mental health issues, we'd find it not 90%, but it would certainly be very high as well. And again, not a place where you would go to get mental health services. That's not your first thinking, I need that kind of help, but this is where people with those kind of problems end up. So how do we successfully intervene in those ways and get them out of there? And it's going to take some redirection of resources, isn't it?
Yeah.
So that's for sure. I'm very interested in what you said about making vaping, because that's something that's been also the state legislature has been looking at, and the federal FDA, and the whole marijuana question is something that the legislature's been looking at as well. And I know earlier in the year, I think they were all looking at, oh, this is a wonderful source of tax dollars, but it's going to be tax dollars that are going to have to be spent on treatment, isn't it? If we open up some of these doors. So you mentioned a little bit about your meetings, but you're also doing some community forums as well. And that there's three of them taking place this month in May, and they're being run by the Fort Drum Regional Health Planning Organization for the health department. Why are you using the Fort Drum organization? What resources do they have that you don't have?
Right. So with the grant that we have, one of the strategies is to do a community-wide assessment. And so to do that, what we want to do is to gather the surveillance data we have, try to improve that. We want to gather the data we have for treatment services, for the, like, for the referrals, all of the kind of resources we have. We wanted to do key informant interviews. We want to do the community forums. And so we want to be able to gather all of this data. And so if you look at what I've just said, we have some of the quantitative or the numbers, but we also need the subjective side. So what are the perceptions of what's going on? When you merge those two things, hopefully we'll get a good picture. Because I think sometimes if you have a perception of what's going on, it doesn't really matter what you do. So to try to understand, you know, what people think. And so with this grant, FDRHPO does have the expertise to do the qualitative work, to do the interviews, to run the focus groups. And so that's why they're our subcontractor for the grant. So the first forum is this evening, so that's where I'll be going just after this.
Right, so it's in Messina, and there's two more forums, one in Canton and one in Ogdensburg. And you've opened those up to the public, and you ask that people register so that you, because there's a limit to how many people you can accommodate for one of these. What, if someone goes to one of these forums, what can they expect to have happen?
So what the forum is simply a set of questions just to ask people, what do they think is going on? So when the forum starts, they're going to do a few activities just to kind of get the conversation started, and then go back and ask questions like, so how have you been affected? You know, what do you think is going on? Because we want to know, for the community in general, what are the thoughts? And so we hope that that everyone will come. And so the first two are from 3:30 to 5:30. The one that's been added for the Ogdensburg location is from 6 to 8. So we're hoping to capture people, you know, when they can come after work. I mean, I think this information is going to be some of the most kind of valuable.
Right, and it will give you a place to start when you go to actually take, as you said, your quantitative data and start trying to figure out how to create the programming. So one of the task force's goals is to improve access and availability of substance abuse treatment. So what's the status of treatment available? Because I know one of the problems has been there are not enough inpatient options or beds anywhere for this. So what's the situation here in St. Lawrence County right now, and what kind of resources do we have to put into place to get what we need available for folks?
Right. So part of the strategy that I was just talking about is trying to look at how do we gather the data on what we have. Because we are so big, you know, sometimes people don't even know who's doing what. So we have one detox center, and that's at the Governor Hospital. We have two inpatients. So I think together with those two, which I believe is CPH and the St. Lawrence, the Addiction Treatment Center, we have about like 58 beds for inpatient. For outpatient-wise, I think there's four or five programs. We have 9 MAP providers, so that those are providers that can prescribe the buprenorphine. So we are doing trainings to get more providers who can actually do the prescribing. So we actually have 2 waiver trainings. You need to get a waiver to provide that prescription. And those are occurring next Saturday on the 18th and June 1st. So if you're a doctor, a nurse practitioner, or a PA, you can attend those to get your waiver. So that's happening. We also have one residential inpatient treatment center, and that is for kids and the adolescent population. And then we also have the Grace House and the Freedom Homes, which is kind of a transitional kind of a living situation to go when you're in the recovery process. There are other things. There is the Messina Drug Free Task Force. There is the Clubhouse in Messina. So that's an area where people can go, where it's a substance-free kind of area. They put on some of the events. There's Step-by-Step in Ogdensburg area. They have some of the programming. And so those are the resources we have. As far as knowing what more we need, I think we're still waiting for the numbers and kind of the assessment to kind of come about and see what we learn. so that we can have a full understanding, of what that is.
And you had mentioned earlier in our conversation about the babies that are born who their opioid addiction during pregnancy is a real problem, obviously, for the infants. And we're also seeing a crisis in foster care in St. Lawrence County, and much of it is being driven by the opioid crisis. So what do we need to put into place to help these youngest members of our society who, through no fault of their own, are in this situation?
Well, I think that's where, like the early intervention program kind of comes in, making sure that they get the connection to services, and then providing the educations, to young moms and before you get pregnant. I mean,
right.
That's really where we have to start, because once you're in that situation, all you can do is provide the intervention that might be necessary. And, when you're a young baby, you're not even sure what the ramifications are going to be.
Yeah. Unfortunately, that's something we're learning a lot more about, isn't
yeah.
it?
Yeah.
So clearly the need is here, and each task force meeting grows in terms of your audience. And having to find a bigger venue has been a good problem, hasn't it, for this? So you've kind of keep moving around looking for more space. Where are you anticipating the next few meetings being held?
The last meeting was at the Canton Best Western, mm-hmm. and that's where we're going to hold for the
okay.
next few months. So it's always the second Friday of the month. They start
mm-hmm.
At 10 o'clock, mm-hmm. and they're in the Laurentian room.
Mm-hmm.
So that's where we have spread our wings to. So
right, and this is open to anybody with an interest in this. You don't have to be connected to it. If you just want to be, if you want to find out more, you're welcome to come and join this effort, right?
Definitely. Yes.
So that's good. This is an important thing to build some community around, because for people who are in this situation, they need to know they're not alone, and that there is support out there. It's very important, isn't it?
Yeah.
To keep the relapse from happening. So as we get ready to close up, any final thoughts about this? It sounds like you have got a really great start, and you're starting to get your feet under you a little bit, but there's still a lot of work left, isn't there?
There is, yep. There's a lot of structuring we need to do,
mm-hmm.
as the task force, really trying to hone in on what are some of the first activities we want to do, and so we're just kind of getting started. So my whole thing is, I hope we can keep the momentum up,
mm-hmm.
because you start something and I think people get excited, so just making sure that you offer what people need and we actually
mm-hmm.
start to do something to show the impact, I think will be really important.
Yeah, great. Well, we appreciate your work, because, again, this is something that is not unique to the North Country by any means. Many, many parts of the country, a lot of rural parts of the country, are really struggling with this. And it's, as I started out by saying, when you get the local politicians all on the bandwagon, then that's going to help when it gets time to redirecting some resources, because they really do understand and they're committed to solving the problem, and by bringing all the other stakeholders together, we stand a good chance of making some real progress, don't we?
We do.
All right.
Yeah.
Well, thank you for coming in, Dana. This is an important topic, and one we're going to want to follow up on as time goes on and you get a better handle on what's going on. I hope you'll come back and tell us more.
Certainly.
Great, thank you. So this has been a production of North Country Matters, which is filmed here in the Fred W. Cleveland Computer Center of the Potsdam Public Library. These shows are a civic collaboration between the League of Women Voters of St. Lawrence County and the Potsdam Public Library. Until next time, remember, our North Country matters.
Thanks. Thank you very much.
That was